The Good Friday liturgy begins on page 565 of the prayer book. Page 565. Let us stand for a silent procession, and then we will kneel for silent prayer. Let us kneel or be seated. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way.
And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we beseech you graciously to behold this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed and given into the hands of sinners and to suffer death upon the cross, who now lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Let us be seated for the reading of the lessons.
Here I am. He said, take Please turn to page 354 in the Book of Common Prayer. It's Psalm 69. We will read it responsively by half verse, beginning with verse 1. Again, found on page 354. Save me, O God. I sink down in the deep mire where there was no ground. I am weary of crying. My throat is dry. Those who hate me without a cause are more than the hairs of my head. They bid me restore things I never took. Let not those who trust in you, O Lord God of hosts, be ashamed because of me.
Let not those who seek you be confounded through me, O God of Israel.
Surely for your sake have I suffered reproach.
Shame has covered my face.
I have become a stranger to my brethren.
Unknown to my mother's children.
Because zeal for your house has consumed me. I wept and humbled myself with fasting.
But that has turned my reproach.
I put on sackcloth also. Those who sit in the gate speak against me. But Lord, I make my prayer to you. Hear me, O God, in the multitude of your mercy. Take me out of the mire, lest I sink. Let not the floodwaters drown me, neither let the deep swallow me up. Hear me, O Lord, for your loving kindness is good. And hide not your face from your servant, for I am in trouble. You have known my reproach, my shame, and my dishonor.
My adversaries are all on your side.
Reproach has broken my heart. I am full of heaviness.
I know that some have pity on me, but there was no one. I never found any comfort.
They gave me gall to eat.
And when I was thirsty, they gave me vinegar to drink.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Please turn to page 1006 in your Pew Bible for our third reading, which is from the book of Hebrews, chapter 10, beginning with verse 1. That's again found on page 1006. For since the law has but a shadow of all the good things to come instead of the true form of these realities, it can never, by the same sacrifices that are continually offered every year, make perfect those who draw near. Otherwise, would they not have ceased to be offered, since the worshipers, having once been cleansed, would no longer have any consciousness of sins? But in these sacrifices, there is a reminder of sins every year. For it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. Consequently, when Christ came into the world, he said, "Sacrifices and offerings you have not desired, but a body have you prepared for me, and burnt offerings and sin offerings you have taken no pleasure." Then I said, "Behold, I have come to do your will, O God, as it is written of me in the scroll of the book." When he said above, "You have neither desired nor taken pleasure in sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and sin offerings, these are offered according to the law." Then he added, "Behold, I have come to do your will." He does away with the first in order to establish the second. And by that we will have been sacrificed through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. And every priest stands daily at his service, offering repeatedly the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God, waiting from that time until his enemies should be made a footstool for his feet. For by a single offering, he has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified. And the Holy Spirit also bears witness to us. For after saying, "This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days," declares the Lord, "I will put my laws on their hearts and write them in their minds." And then he adds, "I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more." Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin. Therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how to stir one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please remain seated for the first portions of the gospel read. The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. John. When Jesus had spoken these words, he went out with his disciples across the brook Kidron, where there was a garden which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, for Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas, having procured a band of soldiers and some officers from the chief priests and the Pharisees, went there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that would happen to him, came forward and said to them, "Whom do you seek?" They answered him, "Jesus of Nazareth." And Jesus said to them, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. So he asked them again, "Whom do you seek?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. So if you seek me, let these men go." This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "Of those whom you gave me, I have lost not one." Then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's servant and cut off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus. So Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword into its sheath. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father has given me?" So the band of soldiers and their captain and the officers of the Jews arrested Jesus and bound him. First they led him to Annas, for he was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had advised the Jews that it would be expedient that one man should die for the people. Simon Peter followed Jesus, and so did another disciple. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he entered with Jesus into the court of the high priest. But Peter stood outside at the door. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out and spoke to the servant girl who kept watch at the door and brought Peter in. The servant girl at the door said to Peter, "You also are not one of this man's disciples, are you?" Peter said, "I am not." Now the servants and officers had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing and warming themselves. Peter also was with them, standing and warming himself. The high priest then questioned Jesus about his disciples and his teaching. Jesus answered him, "I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple, where all Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Ask those who have heard me what I said to them. They know what I said. When he had said these things, one of the officers standing by struck Jesus with his hands, saying, "Is that how you answer the high priest?" And Jesus answered him, "If what I said is wrong, bear witness about the wrong. But if what I said is right, why do you strike me?" Annas then sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. So they said to him, "You also are not one of his disciples, are you?" Peter denied it and said, "I am not." One of the servants of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked, "Did I not see you in the garden with him?" Peter again denied it, and at once a rooster crowed. Then they led Jesus from the house of Caiaphas to the governor's headquarters. It was early morning. They themselves did not enter the governor's headquarters so that they would not be defiled, but could eat the Passover. So Pilate went outside to them and said, "What accusation do you bring against this man?" They answered him, "If this man were not doing evil, we would not have delivered him over to you." Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and judge him by your own law." The Jews said to him, "It is not lawful for us to put anyone to death." This was to fulfill the word that Jesus had spoken to show by what kind of death he was going to die. So Pilate entered his headquarters again and called Jesus and said to him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you say this of your own accord, or did others say it to you about me?" Pilate answered, "Am I a Jew? Your own nation and the chief priests have delivered you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would have been fighting that I might not be delivered over to the Jews. But my kingdom is not from the world." Then Pilate said to him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this purpose I was born, and for this purpose I have come into the world, to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth listens to my voice." Pilate said to him, "What is truth?" After he had said this, he went back outside to the Jews and told them, "I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I should release one man for you at the Passover. So do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?" They cried out again, "Not this man, but Barabbas." Now, Barabbas was a robber. Then Pilate took Jesus and flogged him. And the soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head and arrayed him in a purple robe. They came up to him saying, "Hail, King of the Jews," and struck him with their hands. Pilate went out again and said to them, "See, I am bringing him out to you that you may know that I find no guilt in him." So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, "Behold the man." When the chief priests and the officers saw him, they cried out, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and crucify him, for I find no guilt in him." The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die because he has made himself the Son of God." When Pilate heard this statement, he was even more afraid. He entered his headquarters again and said to Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. So Pilate said to him, "You will not speak to me? Do you not know that I have authority to release you and authority to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You would have no authority over me at all unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, he who delivered me over to you has the greater sin." From then on, Pilate sought to release him, but the Jews cried out, "If you release this man, you are not Caesar's friend. Everyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar." So when Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and sat down on the judgment seat at a place called the Stone Pavement, and in Aramaic, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation of the Passover. It was about the sixth hour. He said to the Jews, "Behold your king." They cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but Caesar." So Pilate delivered him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and he went out, bearing his own cross, to the place called the Place of a Skull, which in Aramaic is called Golgotha. Let us stand. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, and Jesus between them. Pilate also wrote an inscription and put it on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this inscription, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Aramaic, in Latin, and in Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write 'the King of the Jews,' but rather, 'This man said, I am the King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his garments and divided them into four parts, one part for each soldier, also his tunic. But the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from top to bottom. So they said to one another, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to see whose it shall be." This was to fulfill the scripture which says, "They divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots." So the soldiers did these things, but standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her to his own home. After this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said, to fulfill the scripture, "I thirst." A jar full of sour wine stood there. So they put a sponge full of the sour wine on a hyssop branch and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the soured wine, he said, "It is finished." And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Let us kneel or be seated. And let us stand. Since it was the day of preparation, and so that the bodies would not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for that Sabbath was a high day, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once there came out blood and water. He who saw it has borne witness. His testimony is true, and he knows that he is telling the truth, that you also may believe. For these things took place that the scripture might be fulfilled, "Not one of his bones will be broken." And again, another scripture says, they will look on him whom they have pierced.
Pray with me, please. Holy Spirit, breath of God and fire of love, we cannot pray, we cannot preach, we cannot receive preaching without your aid. Kindle in us the fire of your love and illumine us with your light, that with steadfast wills and holy thoughts, we may now approach the Father in spirit and in truth through Jesus Christ our Lord, who reigns with you and the Father in eternal union. Amen. You may be seated. Last night at the end of our Monday-Thursday service, I had a quick story pop into my mind. It's one of those kind of funny workplace conversation stories that happen every once in a while in an office. It must have been a few months ago where a few of the office folks and I were talking about the different kinds of people when they get home. There's a certain kind of person when they get home, they go immediately into pajama pants, right? That's me. As soon as you get home, the first thing you gotta do is get into something comfortable and then relax. There are other types of people, I guess, I wouldn't know because I'm not one of them, they go home and put on work clothes and go work outside or something, but I'm the kind of pajama pants right away kind of person. Why did that pop into my mind last night after Monday, Thursday? Well, because it was the first time for me being involved in the stripping of the altar. Last year, I recited the Psalm 22, during the stripping, but I actually participated this time in taking stuff down, and this thing is thick, it's hot. I mean, when you're up there moving and you're carrying big things, and I got uncomfortable. I was hot, I was sweaty, I was not comfortable, and I thought to myself, this is not going to get any better when I stand outside, because outside is warmer right now than it is right here. Sometimes it is, or at least it should be, downright embarrassing what upsets us or what we complain about. Here are a few of some recent ones for me, you might say. The weeds in the yard. Too many. Maybe the grill got a little rusty, you have to place a few parts, and that costs money and time, and that's not fun. Maybe your sports team that you dearly love and you root for all the time, maybe it lost. Or here's the one that's the real kicker for me. This is the one that I can really get my temperature up on. When the phone just won't work. A couple weeks ago, I was one of the guest speakers for St. John's Florence doing their Lenten series. And I know a little bit about how to get around, but I'm still kind of new to the area, so I don't exactly know how to go. I know that you need to go north on Fraser, but then there's that split in the road, right? You can keep going straight. You can turn left at the Francis Marion gas station. And I don't know which way to go, and I know decision time's coming, and I'm heavily reliant on my phone. My phone just, it needs to work. It needs to tell me the way. It needs to give me GPS directions, and it simply will not work. And I've done everything right. I mean, I started off early. I knew what time I was going to get there. I texted the church beforehand to say I'm on my way. And my phone will not give me the directions. And I remember going north on Fraser and pulling into Morningside's parking lot, that care home that is no longer in operation. And I'm just sitting there, just kind of, I'm angry and I'm almost crying out in pain. And I'm so frustrated that my stupid phone won't work. Because I, as many of us are, I think, are addicted to comfort. In a cultural mode, this is called decadence. A lot of cultural commentators have kind of used that word for the place that the Western culture is in right now. When a culture reaches the heights of affluence and wealth, it reaches a place where all of the troubles that used to plague us, things like famine, war, most sicknesses, they're so far in the rearview mirror that it's the little things from then on out that really get us, something as inane as a phone not working. A definition of decadence, moral or cultural decline, is characterized by excessive indulgence in pleasure or luxury. Luxurious self-indulgence, you might say. We crave comfort and shun discomfort. And yet at Good Friday, we stare into the face of the one who chose the ultimate path of suffering and pain for our sake and for our salvation, and we have the unmitigated gall to complain when our phones don't work. Or when the sermon is a little longer than you thought it should be. Or the church service is a bit long. Fill in the blank with whatever inane thing that you complain about, because there's probably something. But in the face of Good Friday, when Jesus is taking all of the sin and wrath of God onto himself, the sin of us and the wrath of God onto himself, we have the gall to complain back to him when something extremely minor in the grand scheme of things goes wrong. And here's, of course, the most embarrassing part of that particular story that I shared is because, of course, I'm praying in the car, pulling over and just pleading with God, please, God, let my phone work, let my phone work, let my phone work. How do you think Jesus receives those prayers of complaint? I mean, you might think, I can imagine that some of us might think that Jesus is just kind of up there and just, seriously? Maybe he turns, if this is Trinitarianly incorrect, so don't. But he turns to the Father and the Holy Spirit and says, you see this guy? I mean, are you kidding? Do you see this? Do you see what he's complaining about? Do you see what he's crying about? Do you see what he's praying about? Maybe Jesus does that. Maybe in extreme cases, Jesus does that every once in a while. But actually, I don't think he does it that way. We get a hint, I think, of what his response might be in our gospel. Verse 4 of chapter 18, then Jesus, knowing all that would happen to him, came forward and said to them, whom do you seek? They answered him, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus said to them, I am he. Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, I am he, they drew back and fell to the ground. So he asked them again, whom do you seek? And they said, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus answered, I told you that I am he. So if you seek me, let these men go. This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken. Of those whom you gave me, I have lost not one. Jesus knows everything that's about to happen to him. And he still puts himself in between his ungrateful disciples and the mob. These same disciples who are in moments about to abandon him. Peter, who at the end of chapter 13 of this gospel is insistent to Jesus, Jesus, not me, I'll go with you to the death. If death is where we're headed, sign me up. I'll stick with you no matter what. I'm coming with you. To which Jesus responds with the infamous, the famous prophecy of his denial. Peter, you're so far off, you have no clue. By the end of this night, you'll betray me, deny me 3 times. And he knows Peter will deny him. He knows that his disciples are about to scatter. He knows that each one of us, if we were there, we would choose Barabbas the terrorist over Jesus the king. In all of our bluster, we might take the words of Peter on ourselves. Not me, Jesus. I'm with you. And we'd be just as wrong as Peter was. And yet he responds to all our betrayal, not by betraying us in turn, but by simply reinforcing his great love and compassion for us. On the cross, he places himself between us and the wrath of God, taking our sin on himself, dying the death that we deserve. Sometimes, don't you just hate it? When the person that you've offended and you've wronged treats you with kindness. You ever done that? When the person that you wrong responds to you with grace and forgiveness, does it ever kind of tick you off a little bit? Has this ever happened in a marriage, say? I've done this with my wife, I'm sure more than the one time that I can think of, but when you're in a fight and you're the one in the wrong clearly and the spouse is just being perfectly amiable, peaceable, it can, if you let it, it might get you a little mad. It's gotten me mad before. The ungratefulness that displays. The concern there is not with what's real, what's true, what's good in the moment, but simply with the keeping of records, making sure that you're more right than they are. And the amazing truth of the cross is that even in our ungratefulness for our salvation, we are forgiven. Even when Jesus is being perfectly good to us, as he always is, And we throw it back in his face because it just kind of ticks us off that Jesus can't just mess up one time when we've wronged him. We're forgiven for that too. This comes from our Hebrews passage, Hebrews 10. When Christ came into the world, he said, "Sacrifices and offerings you have not desired, but a body you have prepared for me. In burnt offerings and sin offerings you have taken no pleasure. Then I said, behold, I've come to do your will, O God, as it is written in me of the scroll of the book. When he said above, you have neither desired nor taken pleasure in sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and sin offerings. These are offered according to the law. Then he added, behold, I have come to do your will. He does away with the first in order to establish the second. And by that will, we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. Every priest stands daily at his service, offering repeatedly the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But when Christ had offered once for all times a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God, waiting from that time until his enemies should be made a footstool for his feet. For by a single offering, he has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified." Perfected for all time. That's what salvation is. That we are perfect in God's sight because of the righteousness of Jesus Christ on the cross, given to us in faith. That's how big the gospel is. That's how amazing the gospel is, that even when we're ungrateful, even when we fail to feel as we should the guilt of our sin, that even those are forgiven. If you are a little guilty, if you feel a little guilty for your ungratefulness to God, then good. You see, if we aren't tinged with just a little bit of guilt for our complaining about some absolutely inane things, then I think we're a bit like the woman from Fleming Rutledge's great little story in her meditation called The Common Criminal. She tells the story of an Episcopal woman who, for the first time, went through the Palm Sunday Passion reading where it's dramatized. And the congregation takes the part of the crowd, and during that dramatization, the crowd has to cry out, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" And they were talking about that service. It was her first, this lady's. She calls her Jane. It was Jane's first. And as they're talking about this service, kind of debriefing it at the coffee hour, that moment comes up and everyone's saying, "Isn't that a powerful moment where you have to say, crucify him, crucify him yourself?" And Jane turns and says, no, I couldn't do it. I just couldn't say those words. It was too hard. This is what Fleming Rutledge says about that person. "I've often thought since how terribly sad that was. In her stubborn blindness, Jane could not identify herself as a sinner like all the rest of us. She could not admit that she too was capable of evil thoughts and malicious deeds. She was preoccupied with her own virtue and her own religiousness." If we're sitting here thinking, "Good thing this doesn't apply to me, I'm the most grateful Christian I know," we aren't seeing the cross properly. He has perfected for all time, Hebrews says. As grateful as we are for Jesus, we're not perfectly grateful. As guilty as we may feel for the sin that we've committed, we don't perfectly understand or feel the guilt that we should feel. And even these, the smallest of failures to the largest of sins, even these are forgiven and covered up by his perfection. Our response to this Good Friday good news, it shouldn't be perfect thankfulness, because that's not possible, but rather growing gratitude. Shouldn't be perfect recognition of guilt, what you might call perfect penitence, because I don't think that's possible, but rather a growing sense of the evil of our sin and a growing desire to shun sin and live into holiness. I'd like to end with two prayers from our prayer book. I want to comment on one and then pray the other. The first is on page 25, should you care to open it up and look at it. It's one of those prayers that happens twice in the daily office, daily morning and daily evening prayer. It's called the general thanksgiving. It's the kind of thing that if you're rushed, the rubrics allow you to skip, and so I skip it a lot, but I shouldn't. Because if we pray this and we mean it as best we can, I think it'll inculcate in us the heart that is truly thankful. Page 25, Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life. Just think about that. Your creation is a gift from God. The only reason you're here right now is because he has preserved you from the point of your creation onward. And every good and perfect gift that you have ever received is from him. But above all of these gifts is this greatest gift. Above all, for your immeasurable love and the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ. For the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. It's only when we recognize the magnitude of the good news of the gospel that we are perfect in God's eyes. Not because of anything we've done, and not because we didn't fail to do something we shouldn't have, because we do that all the time. It's when we realize that the gospel is based not in our work or failings, but in Jesus' work on our behalf, that we can have, as this prayer says, truly thankful hearts. And then, once we get that, once it's in our hearts and in our bones, I think we can pray, meaning it, this last prayer. Would you pray with me? This is a prayer for submission to God's will. O Holy Spirit, beloved of my soul, I adore you. Enlighten me, strengthen me, guide me, console me. Tell me what I should do. Give me your orders. I promise to submit myself to all that you desire of me and to accept all that you permit to happen to me. Let me know only your will. Amen.
Let us stand and sing hymn number 158. 158. liturgy continues in the prayer book on page 566. You may be seated, or you may kneel if you wish. Page 566. Dear people of God, our Heavenly Father sent His Son into the world not to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved, that all who believe in Him might be delivered from the power of sin and death, and become heirs with Him of everlasting life. We pray, therefore, for people everywhere according to their needs.
Let us pray for the Holy Church throughout the world, that the Lord our God may preserve her in unity, peace, and safety, bringing into divine subjection all powers and principalities, and that He may grant us to dwell in such peace and tranquility that we may show forth the glory of God.
Almighty Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church. Fill it with all truth, in all truth, with all peace. Where it is corrupt, purify it. Where it is in error, direct it. Where in anything it is amiss, reform it. Where it is right, strengthen it. Where it is in want, provide for it. Where it is divided, reunite it. For the sake of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior.
Amen. Amen. Let us pray for Chip, our bishop, and Foley, our archbishop, that the Lord our God, who has appointed them to this office, may preserve them in health and safety for the governance of God's holy people.
Almighty and everlasting God, whose judgment upholds all things both in heaven and on earth, as you have appointed these your servants to be our bishops, so also defend them by your mercy against all adversities, that we, acknowledging you as the great shepherd and overseer of our souls, may so prosper by their care that we may bring forth the fruit of righteousness through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons, and for all God's holy people.
Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of your faithful people is governed and sanctified, receive our supplications and prayers which we offer before you for all members of your holy church, that in their vocation and ministry they may truly and devoutly serve you through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen. Let us pray for Joe, our president, and for all in civil authority, that they, knowing whose ministers they are, may above all things seek God's honor and glory, and that we, remembering whose authority they bear, may faithfully and obediently honor them in accordance with God's holy word.
Almighty God, whose kingdom is everlasting and whose power is infinite, we commend our nation to your merciful care, that being guided by your providence, we may dwell secure in your peace. Grant to our president and to all in authority wisdom and strength to know and to do your will. Fill them with the love of truth and righteousness, and make them ever mindful of their calling to serve this people in your fear through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray for those who are preparing for holy baptism, that the Lord our God may open their hearts to his grace and mercy, that by the washing of regeneration they may obtain the remission of all their sins and be found faithful servants of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Almighty and everlasting God, you multiply your church in every generation. Grant the gifts of faith and understanding to those being instructed in your holy word, that being washed in the waters of baptism, they may be born again and numbered among your adopted children, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray to God the Father Almighty that he would cleanse the world from all evil, deliver it from pestilence and famine, set free those who are in captivity, restore the sick to health, and bring those who travel to a haven of safety.
Gracious God, the comfort of all who sorrow, the strength of all who suffer, let the cry of those in misery and need come to you, that they may find your mercy present with them in all their afflictions. And give us, we pray, the strength to serve them for the sake of him who suffered for us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen. Let us pray for all who are in heresy or schism, that the Lord our God may deliver them from all false doctrine and restore them to the faith and unity of the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church.
O God of truth and love, who desires not the death of sinners, but rather that they should turn from their wickedness and live, look with mercy on those who are deceived by the lies of the world, the flesh, and the devil, that the hearts of those who have gone astray may be restored to wisdom and returned to the way of truth in the unity of your holy church, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray for the Jewish people, that the Lord our God may look graciously upon them and that they may come to know Jesus as the Messiah and as the Lord of all.
Almighty and everlasting God, you established your covenant with Abraham and his seed. Hear the prayers of your church, that the people through whom you brought blessing to the world may also receive the blessing of salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Let us pray for all those who do not believe in Christ, that the Holy Spirit may enlighten them through the gospel and bring them into the way of salvation.
Merciful God, creator of all the peoples of the earth and lover of souls, have compassion on all who do not know you as you are revealed in your Son, Jesus Christ. Let your gospel be preached with grace and power to those who have not heard it. Turn the hearts of those who resist it and bring home to your fold those who have gone astray, that there may be one flock under one shepherd. Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Let us commit ourselves to our God and pray for the grace of a holy life, that with all those who have died in the peace of Christ and those whose faith is known to God alone, we may be accounted worthy to enter into the fullness of joy of our Lord and receive the crown of life in the day of resurrection.
O God of unchangeable power and eternal light, look favorably on your whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery, by the effectual working of your providence, carry out in tranquility the plan of salvation. Let the whole world see and know that things which were cast down are being raised up, and things which had grown old are being made new, and that all things are being brought to their perfection by him, through whom all things were made, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Down the Via Dolorosa in Jerusalem that day, the soldiers tried to clear the narrow street, but the crowd pressed in to see the man condemned to die on Calvary. He was bleeding from a beating, there were stripes upon his back, and he wore a crown of thorns upon his head, and he bore with every step the scorn of those who cried. suffering. Like a lamb came the Messiah, Christ the King. But he chose to walk that road out of his love for you and me. Down the Via Dolorosa, all the way to Calvary. The blood that would cleanse the souls of all men made its way to the heart of Jerusalem. Down the Via Dolorosa, called the way of suffering, like a lamb came the Messiah, Christ our King. But he chose to walk that road out of his love for you. Down the Via Dolorosa, all the way to Calvary.
We are on page 571, the middle sentence. Behold the wood of the cross on which was hung the world's salvation.
O come,
let us adore him. Behold the wood of the cross on which was hung the world's salvation. O come, let us adore him. Behold the wood of the cross on which was hung the world's salvation.
O come, let us adore him.
The reproach is on the following page. The bold sentences are the congregations. O my people, what have I done to you? How have I wearied you? Testify against me. I brought you forth from the land of bondage and led you through the waters of salvation, and you have prepared a cross for your Savior.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us. I led you through the desert 40 years and fed you with the bread of heaven. I brought you into the land of promise, and you have prepared a cross for your Savior.
Holy God, holy and mighty,
holy and immortal one, have mercy upon us.
What could I have done for you that I have not done? I planted you, my vineyard, to bear sweet fruit, but you have become very bitter to me and gave me vinegar for my thirst.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us.
I passed over your firstborn and delivered them from death, and you have delivered me into the hands of my enemies. I led you in the pillar of cloud, and you have led me into the judgment hall of Pilate. O my people, what have I done to you? How have I wearied you? Testify against me.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us. I struck down the kings of the Canaanites for your sake, and you struck my head with a reed. I gave you a royal inheritance, and you have crowned my head with thorns. O my people, what have I done to you? How have I wearied you? Testify against me.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us.
I opened the rock and gave you to drink from the water of life. And you have opened my side with a spear. I raised you on high with great power, and you have hanged me high upon the cross. O my church, What have I done to you? How have I wearied you? Testify against me.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us.
Let us say in unison, Anthem 1,
we glory in your cross, O Lord, and praise and glorify your holy resurrection, for by virtue of your cross, joy has come to the whole world. May God be merciful to us and bless us. Show us the light of his countenance and come to us. Let your ways be known upon earth, your saving health among all nations. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. We glory in your cross, O Lord, and praise and glorify your holy resurrection. For by virtue of your cross, joy has come to the whole world.
While the altar is prepared, let us stand and sing hymn number 172. Hymn number 172.
Truly and earnestly repent of your sins and seek to be reconciled with your neighbors and intend to lead the new life, following the commandments of God and walking in his holy ways, draw near with faith and make your humble confession to Almighty God. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker and judge of us all, we acknowledge and lament our many sins and offenses, which we have committed by thought, word, and deed against your divine majesty, provoking most justly your righteous anger against us. We are deeply sorry for these our transgressions. The burden of them is more than we can bear. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. For your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that has passed, and grant that we may evermore serve and please you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in his great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all those who sincerely repent and with true faith turn to him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil.
Amen. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sin of the world. Our custom on Good Friday is to receive communion from the elements of bread that were consecrated at Maundy Thursday's service, last night's service. So there is no consecration prayer on Good Friday. And a tradition of the church is to receive only in one kind. And so we will observe that tradition tonight, to receive only the bread of communion. You're invited now to come forward to receive communion from the front, starting with the front boxes and working towards the back. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Our Lord Jesus Christ. After the concluding prayer, we will depart in silence until we are outside. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, we pray you to set your passion, cross, and death between your judgment and our souls, now and in the hour of our death. Give mercy and grace to the living, peace and rest to the dead, to your holy church, unity and concord, and to us sinners, everlasting life and glory. For with the Father and the Holy Spirit, you live and reign, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
With your spirit.
Depart.
Depart.